Let us begin our worship service by singing hymn number 362, hymn number 362. Of keeping death away in these unusual circumstances. Death surrounds us everywhere, and from the day we were born, we walk towards the reality of death. It is painful, and we strive to avoid it. Yesterday on Anzac Day, we remember the great souls who fought and sacrificed their lives. The thought of death itself can be scary at times. However, we Christians are guided and motivated by the extraordinary life of Jesus, who conquered death in the most meaningful way. We search the scriptures for our peace and redemption, and we find it evident in the words of Jesus. And we continue to live in the hope during these troubling times as we encounter the reality of death in a very unfamiliar context. But we will survive it and declare victory soon. We have with us today our dear Bishop Kate Proud, who in her capacity has been tirelessly working for the Utnon Episcopate. Bishop promised to come to St. Peter's during Holy Week if I had any health issues leading the service, but I was under God's gracious care. To be true to her promise, Bishop decided to be with us today presiding and preaching, probably a break that you all needed from me. I, on behalf of everyone at St. Peter's, take this opportunity to welcome Bishop Kate to our parish once again.
It is indeed lovely to be with you, even in these circumstances. Thank you for that very warm welcome, John. So our service continues on page 119, and sometimes if I depart from that and use different words, it's because I'm using all of the additions for Easter. Peter said, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Christ is risen. Alleluia.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Pray together.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Hear, O Israel, the Lord our Lord, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. Jesus said, this is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, confident in God's forgiveness.
Merciful God, our Maker and our Judge, we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, and in what we have failed to do. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We repent and are sorry for all our sins. Father, forgive us. Strengthen us to love and obey you in newness of life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who has promised forgiveness to all who turn to him in faith, pardon you and set you free from all your sins, strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to God's people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your
lesson is taken from Acts chapter 2, verse 14 and 36 to 41. Then Peter stood up with the 11, raised his voice, and addressed the crowd. Therefore, let all Israel be assured of this. God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, Brothers, what shall we do? Peter replied, Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. This promise is for you and your children, and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call. With many other words he warned them, and he pleaded with them, Save yourselves from this corrupt generation. Those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm is Psalm 116. In response, I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
I love the Lord, for he heard my voice. He heard my cry for mercy. Because he turned his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
The cords of death entangled me. The anguish of the grave came over me. I was overcome by distress and sorrow. Then I called on the name of the Lord. Lord, save me.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
In my alarm, I said, Everyone is a liar. What shall I return to the Lord for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. Truly I am your servant, Lord. I serve you just as my mother did. You have freed me from my chains.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people.
I will walk in the presence of the Lord in the land of the living.
The second reading is from 1 Peter chapter 1. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Discipline yourselves. Set all your hope on the grace that Jesus Christ will bring you when he is revealed. Like obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires that you formerly had in ignorance. Instead, as he who called you is holy, be holy yourselves in all your conduct, for it is written, You shall be holy, for I am holy. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially, according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring word of God. For all flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers, and the flower falls. But the word of the Lord endures forever. That word is the good news that was announced to you. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Today's gradual hymn is hymn number 28. Hymn number 28. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Gospel of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, as it is recorded in Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, beginning to read at verse 13.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Now on the same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead of them as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour, they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. For the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the living God. Amen.
Amen.
I won't say please be seated because the two in front of me have already seated themselves. But it's really, this is weird, isn't it? Let's acknowledge this is very odd, but it's wonderful that at least we can do this. We can worship God together. Loving at a distance. The American Lutheran pastor and theologian, Nadia Bolz Weber, is a very radical and out there kind of person. She's a real provocateur. And I was particularly struck by a question that she posed on Easter Sunday. It wasn't is Jesus like God, but rather, what if God is like Jesus? What if God is like Jesus? And she goes on, what if God is not who we thought? What if the most reliable way to know God is not through religion, not through reward and punishment, but through a person? That person being Jesus. Jesus is how God chose to reveal God's self. And this, says Nadia, is the game changer, because this is the God who is unafraid to get his hands dirty for the ones he loves. The God of the resurrection, who brings out of death, isn't satisfied with making us good or nice and perfect. God who brings life out of death is about making us new. And we all know that new can be messy. Well, we feel in a mess of a kind right now, don't we? It's called COVID-19. It's messed up our church services. It's messed up our church community life. It's messed up our jobs, our finances, our socializing, our school and study routines, our shopping, our visiting, our connections with family and loved ones. COVID-19 has brought mess into every aspect of our lives, and we're all adjusting to the new. We're all finding ways of worshipping and praying together that are new. We're wondering how to be church, how to be family, how to be work colleagues, how to study effectively, how to maintain social connection at a distance. Yes, it feels like we're in a mess. So what does new life in Jesus look like in our current mess? Remembering what Nadia Bolz-Weber says, that God reaches into the grave-like experiences of our lives and hauls us out and gets dirty hands in the process. Remembering that, we can really take heart from our reading today from the first letter of Peter. Because in that letter, he talks about our call, our common call to holy living, holiness. And we might wonder what that looks like right now in our mess, and how we can possibly do holy living in our new, in our COVID-19 context. Well, Peter tells us in that letter that holiness is a gift from God. So we can't earn it. We can't create it for ourselves. It comes to us from God through Christ. That's where the gift comes from. We become holy, transformed, because God first approaches us, joins us in the flesh, through the self-giving life and death and resurrection of Jesus. And our response to this gift of holiness, as the letter goes on to tell us, is to love one another deeply from the heart. Our holiness, the church's holiness, which is God's gift to us, is oriented towards others. And it comes from Christ. And holiness is our response to that gift of eternal life. It becomes our response. So, living a holy life in 2020 amidst COVID-19, living a holy life is to have confidence that God has not abandoned us. God is right here with us in Jesus, getting his hands dirty, pulling us out of the graves of our anxiety and uncertainty and our unknowing, and leading us into the new. We are still working out what new looks like right now, but as your bishop, I've had some deeply moving glimpses of this new lately. And to me, these glimpses of new have been beautiful examples of loving deeply from the heart. New is like the church bell ringing faithfully in one parish every morning at 10 a.m., reminding the local community that it's being prayed for. New is like the volunteers in one parish who pack the takeaways that can be distributed to the poor who are ever more in need of meals, both morning and night in that area. New is like the sermons and the pew sheets that are hand-delivered to parishioners who don't use technology, and so they can still feel a part of that worshipping community. New is like the Christians walking up and down the streets of their neighbourhood, checking in, checking up, connecting at a distance. New is like the neighbours who come out of hibernation to have a socially distant drink with one another from across the way. This new is not rocket science, but it is certainly godly and holy. Jesus and his disciples knew what it was to be in a mess too, didn't they? And we heard it just a few weeks ago whilst we were still in Lent, when Mary and Martha both get very angry with Jesus after their brother Lazarus had died, and they said, if you had been here, if you'd got here on time, he wouldn't have died. And Jesus himself is seemingly in a mess when he cries out those haunting words in Matthew's gospel that we hear on, or we heard on, Good Friday. My God, why have you abandoned me? And now today, Cleopas and his companion, we don't even know who they are. It's the first and last time they appear. But we do see their downcast faces. We hear their sorrow and their disillusionment making their way away from Jerusalem. Hopes destroyed, grief-stricken, demoralized. They can't bear to stay in that mess of the death of their Lord and teacher. And I don't blame them for turning their backs on it all. Yet, in the Emmaus story from Luke chapter 24 that we heard today, God turns up unobtrusively, quietly companioning them, these two unknown disciples walking somewhere unknown, Emmaus, who knows? God meets them in that ordinary, unknown place called Emmaus. And right there in that mess, their eyes are opened. Not because of what they do, but because of what God does. Gets into their mess and hauls them out. As Jesus stays with them, talks with them, breaks bread with them. And it's then that their eyes are opened and new begins. So it is with us. In the ordinary, unassuming places we find ourselves headed towards right now, like Emmaus, even when we're despairing and dejected and feel like life has thrown us a global, curved COVID-19 ball. one we could never have foreseen even a mere few weeks ago. Like those unknown disciples, we too can have our eyes opened and meet the risen Jesus, God. What if God were like Jesus? God is like Jesus, and we are like Jesus. We are holy as Jesus is holy because Christ has given us the gift of holiness. If God were like Jesus, and God is, God would turn up even in the empty space of a tomb, looking like an angel. And then we'd realize that the very emptiness of the tomb has become the potential, a new beginning. If God were like Jesus, God would turn up and share a humble, ordinary meal at our table and be made known in ordinary bread and wine. And what is nothing special becomes something extraordinary. If God were like Jesus, God would turn up in a phone call from a friend and in a smile as you walked your dog, or when you saw neighbours speaking to one another and showing their new baby through the safety of a fence. If God were like Jesus, God would show up at these times because these times are our holy living. This is us right now living resurrection life. It's our new. It's us right now reaching out to the stranger, the isolated, attending to the person in need, offering compassion and kindness and care in the simplest of ways, in our local backyard, as it were. God would show up because these are the ways we would be loving one another deeply from the heart. And the call to be holy is not just a pastoral one, it's missional, because every time we love deeply from the heart, we are making the word of God fully known. And so it's a very intentional thing that we're doing, because all that we do in the name of the risen Christ. Someone said we have to find something more infectious than coronavirus. True. Living holy lives is infectious. Serving others is infectious. This is the core business of our church. It's the church at work in our small corners. Easter isn't a one-off experience or one Sunday. It's a lifetime of finding ourselves in mess, only to realize that we've been hauled out again, yet again, by God, who, through Jesus, is prepared to get hands dirty and is prepared to put to death whatever is destructive. And so we brush off the dirt and take another step as God's holy people, our hearts strangely warmed, perhaps, to quote the famous 18th century preacher John Wesley. This is our life, and it was the life of those first followers. And with hearts burning, it was what encouraged those two who had been walking away from Jerusalem to Emmaus to get up and return to Jerusalem. Loving one another deeply from the heart, proclaiming in our small ways how we have seen the risen Lord who loves all people. As someone else has said, if you love like that, hopefully you will leave behind a trail of empty tombs. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
us together affirm the faith of the Church.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the world and for the Church.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for all people in parts of this troubled world and in all kinds of need. Lord, shine your light upon those who are suffering from COVID-19 across the world, their families, and especially the healthcare workers. We pray for those who live in danger of violence, persecution, oppression, displacement, injustice due to various reasons. We pray that the hearts of those who visit the evils of prejudice and greed upon others may be turned from darkness and awakened to the true light, the love and compassion of the Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, shine your light upon those who live in fear of disease and upon those who live without hope, faith, or love, that they may know your true love and the joy of your salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, shine your light upon your Church and upon all people of faith, that their love may shine in the darkness, uniting in their endeavors for the common good. May we in the ministries proclaim the good news as our faith shines forth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers.
Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Jesus said, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. We pray together.
We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, precious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ,
and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him
and he in us. Amen.
We are the body of Christ.
His Spirit is with us.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. Through your goodness we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom.
Blessed be God forever.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All glory and honor be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God. We give you thanks and praise for your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, who by the power of your Spirit was born of Mary and lived as one of us. By his death on the cross he offered the one true sacrifice for sin, and obtained an eternal deliverance for his people. And now we give you thanks that you raised him to life triumphant and exalted him in glory. By his victory over death, the reign of sin is ended, a new day dawned, a broken world is restored, and we are made whole once more. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying,
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, Hosanna in the highest.
Merciful God, we thank you for these gifts of your creation, this bread and wine. And we pray that by your word and Holy Spirit, we who eat and drink them may be partakers of Christ's body and blood. On the night he was betrayed, Jesus took bread. And when he had given you thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. After after supper, he took the cup. And again, giving you thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Therefore we do as our Saviour has commanded, proclaiming his offering of himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension. And looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. Renew us by your Holy Spirit, unite us in the body of your Son, and bring us with all your people into the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord, with whom and in whom, in the fellowship of the Holy Spirit, we worship you, Father, in songs of never-ending praise.
Blessings and honor and glory and power are yours forever and ever. Amen.
Savior Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray on page 141.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, our power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. We who are many are one body.
For we all share in the one bread.
Of God for the people of God. Thank you. Most glorious Lord of life, we thank you that you nourish us in these Easter mysteries. Fill us with the spirit of love and unite us in faith, that we may witness to the resurrection and show your glory to all the world. Father,
we offer ourselves to you as a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory.
God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you what is pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.
Take my hands and lead them all, lead them all.